when I grow up, I think the person I'd most like to be is Pop Staples.
I remember hearing on the radio this deep voice singing, "Oh, oh, oh, they tell me," and I thought it was a man.
Do you know what Mavis means in the dictionary? You look it up in the dictionary. It's a songbird.
And somebody said to me, "That's a 12-year-old girl singing."
There's hardly a dimension in black life that cannot be found in the music of the Staples. It is the embodiment of the history of the struggle of black people in America.
This is Bonnie Raitt, the Staples Singers, the spiritual soundtrack of the civil rights movement, next on Chicago Stories.
We get to this bridge dividing Memphis and West Memphis, Arkansas. All of a sudden, I see a big white light, and I said, "Daddy, it's probably the police." He said, "Just drive, Mavis, drive on."
In November 1964, the Staples had finished a concert and were headed toward Memphis. 23-year-old Mavis was driving the night shift. Her sister Cleo was in the back, along with her brother Purvis, who was sleeping under a pile of coats. They were stopped by the police in West Memphis, Arkansas.
We had sang in Jackson, Mississippi. We were paid, and our money was in a cigar box.
The family stopped at a gas station for a fill-up. Mavis asked for a receipt. When the attendant hesitated, Pops, ever the shrewd businessman, got out of the car and got one.
All of a sudden, I see this guy point his finger in Daddy's face like that and said something, you know. And the next thing, I saw Pops swing, you know. And the guy went for a crowbar.
And out from under the pile of coats, Purvis darted out of the car to defend his father.
Pops said, "You know what? If you hadn't pursued him, he would have killed us."
They drove off. As they crossed the Arkansas state border, police lights stopped them. Shotguns were raised. Dogs were barking. And police found a pile of money in the trunk. The gas station attendant told police he'd been robbed.
I just knew that we were going to be lynched or something because it was that time.
When we go into the police station, this guy looked at us. He said, "My wife loves you. You're my wife's husband. We just saw you on Johnny Carson's show last night. Aren't you Pop Staples?" And Pop said, "Yeah, in person."
Pops told the police chief what happened. The police sent them on their way.
The next time we went to Memphis, the entire police force was at the concert.
Pop Staples was born just 100 miles from Memphis on the Dockery Plantation outside Drew, Mississippi. Roebuck and his brother Sears, yes, they were Sears and Roebuck, first heard the blues from musicians who hung around the Plantation General Store. Those musicians included legendary Charlie Patton, whose influence on Pops' sound was profound. In 1935, Pops came to Chicago with his wife Osceola. His first job was working in the Chicago stockyards, shoveling fertilizer and working the hog kill.
My mother sat down and talked to us about how my father made 4 cents, how he worked for us when Cleotha was first born. He was making 4 cents a day. 4 pennies.
Pops continued to work the stockyards while he sang with the quartet at night. He helped introduce rural Delta texture to Chicago gospel music.
He sang with a group called the Trumpet Jubilees. He came in one night upset because these guys weren't serious. He said, "I'm going to sing with my children."
The children were Cleotha, Purvis, Yvonne, Mavis, and Cynthia, all of whom were with the group at one time or another.
The Staples Singers started in their home singing with Roebuck Staples while he was trying to learn how to play this guitar. And that's how they developed it. And it got better and better in the house. And they said, "Let's take it to church."
My first memory of where we lived was 506 East 33rd Street. In fact, at 506 is where we began singing. This is where Pops set us on the floor in a circle and gave us our parts. And Pops would say, Oh, sit down. I said, no, 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 no. Sit down. Oh, please don't make me sit down. 'Cause I just got to heaven. We sang and we rehearsed there on the floor.
The Staples went from singing on their living room floor to their first performance at Mount Calvary Baptist Church, singing the only song they knew, If I Could Hear My Mother Pray Again.
Oh, if I could hear my mother pray again.
We had to sing that song three times. They clapped us back three times because Pops hadn't taught us. We had started learning some other songs, but not all the way through.
So they learned. They started singing in churches and igniting the spirits of the parishioners. Word spread, and they were soon performing their unique sound of folk gospel and Delta blues heard all over the country on nighttime radio.
This train, you know, it's bound for glory, this train.
When record company owners Vivian Carter and her husband Jimmy Bracken heard them around Chicago, they signed them to their VJ record label. The gospel song Uncloudy Day was the Staples' first hit, released in 1957.
Oh, they tell me. Oh, the home.
Uncloudy Day, so like a rock and roll. And when you make a hit, you get yourself something.
Uncloudy Day catapulted the Staples to major folk and gospel festivals throughout the world. Singing on the streets of Harlem, in the arenas of Africa, or the corridors of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, their call of peace and compassion struck a chord with their audiences. But Pops made sure the family stayed grounded.
Pops didn't want us to get too swell-headed. He didn't want us to play superstar stuff. He talked about pencils breaking, and if you all stick together like this, it'd be hard to break you.
But the Staples' breakthrough attracted a galaxy of admirers. The Jackson Five, Sammy Davis Jr., Bob Dylan, Mayor Richard J. Daley, and Natalie Merchant. Near the end of his life, Pop Staples was awarded a National Heritage Fellowship from the National Endowment of the Arts by President and Mrs. Clinton. But as wide as their influence reached, they remained humble.
The Staples were very unique. They had a talent I don't even know if they knew they had it.
The gospel and the blues both have very sad origins, born of pain. Difference is, in the blues, you go down twice, you come up once. The gospel has always a good news ending.
Glory, 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 glory.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah.
Just hallelujah.
My burden down.
My burden down.
My burden down.
Glory.
The Staples found a new audience in the early 60s folk scene. They called their hybrid of folk and gospel message songs.
We started out strictly gospel and then went on over to the message.
When we felt that the world was coming together, things were going to be all right, we began writing what we called message songs.
Pop's guitar helped create the backbeat for their message. It was a statement of will, compassion, and conviction that he preached in his songs as well as to his family.
They would talk of riding down the highways on their trips, writing songs, speaking about the objective conditions of social segregation. And many groups accepted their place in the back of the bus. The Staples did not.
We wouldn't go to the back door to the restaurants. Pops said, no, we're not going to do that. So we would go to grocery stores and get us some cold cuts and bread and make our sandwiches and sit in the car.
The Staples found a world of equality in the message of Dr. Martin Luther King. It became an inspiration for them to join the movement.
People get ready, there's a
train.
We met Dr. King in 1963 in Montgomery, Alabama, and Pops called us all to his room and said, listen, you all, I'm going down to Dexter Avenue Baptist Church to see Dr. Martin Luther King. I really like this man's message. I think if he can preach that, we can sing it. And we said, okay, Daddy. So we started writing protest songs.
The dignified and equally determined Harry Belafonte met Dr. King in 1956 in a Harlem church where he was recruited for the movement. Belafonte was impressed with Dr. King's air of humility and resolution, the same treasures he would come to discover in the Staples Singers.
He saw us, who came from that world, as a mighty, mighty force in the cause of change.
Our first protest song we wrote was March Up Freedom's Highway. That was for the march from Montgomery to Selma. Then we wrote It's a Long Walk to D.C. That was for the march to Washington, D.C. And on and on, We'll Get Over. When will we be paid for the work we've done?
When will we be paid for the work we've done? When will we be paid for the work we've done?
We have worked this country from shore to shore. Our women cooked all your food and washed all your clothes.
We joined the movement. We traveled with Dr. King.
Pops and Dr. King would talk about how the movement was growing.
He looked down on me and said, Brother Staple, I want you to sing my song. I want you to sing my song tonight. I said, yes, sir. I said, what is it? He said, why am I treated so bad? And I sung that song that night. I dedicated it to Miss Scott and all the children. And the song go, why am I treated so bad?
I asked her about why am I treated so bad, and she said that Pops had written that after he saw people not allowing children to get on school buses, black children to get on school buses to integrate the schools.
And so from then on, we sung different songs with him, and every time we could get together, he was doing lots of work. We were too, and we figured up a row. He could preach it, we could sing it.
That turned out to be Dr. King's favorite. That was some cherished memories, meeting Dr. King and traveling with him, listening to him speak every night. Just moments you'll never forget.
The song and the power of the song was one of the most powerful of our weapons, and not a very silent one at that. And Dr. King felt that this was a critical part of human expression, a critical part of the human voice, a critical part of how we understood who we were.
Another way Chicago artists would commit themselves to the movement was through Operation Breadbasket. It was started in 1962 by the Southern Christian Leadership Conference under the creed to put bread, money, and income into the baskets of poor people. A few years later, Dr. King recruited a young minister named Jesse Jackson to manage it. The workers came together at rallies held at the International Amphitheater on Chicago's South Side.
Dr. King asked Pops for us to sing at Breadbasket. That was the night that he appointed Jesse Jackson head of Breadbasket.
We'd have these big concerts at the amphitheater. They were raising money. They would have seminars and business roundtables. I recall Flip Wilson and Chaka Khan and the Staples Singers.
Dr. King was sitting right down there. You felt proud that you were in his presence.
On April 4th, 1968, Dr. King was assassinated on the balcony of the Lorraine Motel in Memphis. Pop Staples was finishing a performance when he heard the news. He was devastated.
When Dr. King got killed, that hurt him, man. I mean, that tore him apart. We was in Nashville, Tennessee. We heard it on the radio. He stopped, just suddenly stopped in the middle of the highway there and said, let's go home.
Pops poured his grief into songs that reflected the times.
There was a time I wish my hair was fine, and I can remember when I wish my lips were thin. Oh, but now I wonder, why should I be surprised? I like the things about me. I like the things about me. I like the things about me that I once despised.
And he suggested other writers do the same.
Pops used to tell the songwriters, if you want to write a song for us, read the headlines.
Take the sheet off. The
The Staples found a sympathetic ear in producer-songwriter Al Bell at Stax Records in Memphis. The Staples recorded their best-known songs at Stax, including the top 10 hit, Respect Yourself.
It had such a groove to it, and Pops was singing it. Pops is so cool. It's a classic. And to this day, Respect Yourself is my favorite song. And Pops, we always wanted to reach the youth. And so he said, we'll get us a rhythm section. If we get a rhythm section, that music might grab those children's ear. And we got a rhythm section, we started writing these songs.
The first time I heard the Staples Singers was when I was a child. I probably heard Respect Yourself or Give a Hand, or I'll Take You There on the radio. Pops really had a desire to cross over to people like me.
I heard Hope with Respect Yourself. We listened for beat, for a good story, for a feeling of what was going on at the time. The Staples Singers had that. That Respect Yourself was just great because that was a problem with black people. There wasn't enough respect.
We had people like the Blackstone Rangers coming to Pops saying, Pops, I'm so glad you and your daughters recorded that song, Respect Yourself. He said, I didn't realize that I hadn't been respecting myself. I would get on the bus, and if an elderly lady got on with bags and whatnot, he said, I'd sit there, you know. But after I heard that song, I would stand up and let her sit down, yeah.
When we saw Hillary and Bill Clinton, we sung Respect Yourself. And man, they sung it. I'd never heard Pops and Mavis singing like that before.
When the Staples sing, there is such an absolute truth to all of the dimensions of the utterance, of the very moment in which how the harmony comes, how the timbre of the voice raises each note.
Who made the mountain, the river, and the sea? Who made the sunshine, flowers, and the trees?
How the face and the entire body reflects the passion that is contained in the lyrics of most of the songs that they sing, if not all. And when you listen to the Staples Singers, I think you hear black art at its finest expression.
The Staples have been internationally known for more than 40 years. But in Chicago, they are nearly as famous for their big barbecues as they are for their singing. The Staples had never had a backyard until the 1960s, when they bought their first home at 89th and Langley on the South Side. They made good use of the yard, playing host to friends, neighbors, and celebrities such as Olympian Jesse Owens, gospel singer Mahalia Jackson, and R&B singer Ray Charles, who wanted to franchise Mama Staples' sweet potato pie.
They became stars, but like low-hanging grapes on a vine, they were stars that we could touch. The Staples became kind of a every man's group.
Our door was always open whether we were there or not. That was like home. My mother was mom to all of them.
At that time, they really couldn't eat downtown, number one. But to have home-cooked meal, we would always end up at the Staples home.
Pop Staples is a guy you could just walk up to and talk.
He'd always call me neighbor, you know. And I'd always speak to him, you know, because he had that smile on his face.
We had a festival or something. But my mother cooked like that all the time, even when we went out on the road. We come home, it was just like a holiday, you know? I mean, she had it laid out.
They go over to the Staples house to eat some neck bones. Homemade ice cream, black-eyed peas, butter beans, ham hocks, everything, barbecue ribs, you know, beef ribs, lamb ribs. Oh, just food. Good food.
The barbecues were a living embodiment of their gospel conviction.
I think the Staples legacy is they never crossed the line. I can never recall hearing the Staples Singers sing a love song or anything else that was not directly kind of related to either personal improvement or to spiritual improvement.
I'll take you there.
Come on, y'all. Say, ooh, ah.
I could relate to them. I loved what I saw, the families singing together and sticking together and loving what they, you know, did and touching lives through their music. So it was, you know, easy for me to say, I want to be like them. I want to do what they're doing. And they paved the way for us.
I think what's even more remarkable is that they never, ever journeyed from who they are and what they're about. And they've endured. And it is much to our delight and our reward that they've chosen to be that and stay that way.
Go down, Moses. There's nothing that you can say.
The Staple Singers have been empowered by the red soil of the Delta and the blue streets of Chicago. They confronted the somber sound of injustice and answered with a chorus of reliance. When we are searching for compassion and inspiration, we need not look further than the Staple Singers. They will always take us there.